สวัสดีครับ good afternoon everyone. It's a long time that I have never been on stage since working in a medical school outside of Bangkok. So today in the 20 minutes I'm there now to share with you the 20 years experience of cryptococcal meningitis in HIV and AIDS patient. So it's not easy because I just learned that the audience half are microbiologists and half are clinicians. So just forgive me if I cannot satisfy all of you. Okay, I have nothing to disclose since I just work in a medical school. So before the availability of ART or antiretroviral therapy, most of our HIV patients present with AIDS and many have opportunistic infection. Cryptococcosis or cryptococcal meningitis, the most common presentation, is one of the most common OI among our AIDS patients in that period of time. And a study by my professor many years ago had shown very well that without ART, they have very short survival after presenting with the first opportunistic infection. And the pictures of survival curve show you different kind of opportunistic infection. You can see that overall, the median survival is about 17 months. However, in the group who present with cryptococcal meningitis, only 6.3 months is the median survival. So we lose a lot of patients. We lost a lot of patients at that day before we have ART. After in the interchange period that ART was introduced in our clinical practice and become available in some setting, we have retrospective cohort study showing that with ART, we can save a lot of patients. The median survival is much changed from 75% survival of the patient had been changed from around 6 months to greater than 54 months in patients who receive ART. So you cannot talk about cryptococcal meningitis without mentioning ART in the real setting. In addition, ART also had the impact on the relapse of the disease. We can see that there is a significant decreased rate of the relapse of cryptococcal meningitis in HIV patients between those who had ART and who did not receive ART. So if it's very common in our setting in that day, why we let it happen? So some patients, we have think about primary prophylaxis for cryptococcosis. However, more than 20 years ago, the study in the Western country did not show the survival benefit of the primary prophylaxis for cryptococcal meningitis, so they never recommended. However, a study in Thailand between Ramathibodit and Khonkan University had showed the survival benefit if you give primary prophylaxis for cryptococcal meningitis with fluconazole 400 milligrams once weekly. And this is significant and also shows safe survival benefit. Since then, in Thailand, we have recommended to use primary prophylaxis with fluconazole 400 milligrams weekly for HIV-infected patients who present with CD4 less than 100, and the prophylaxis had keep going. After our study, WHO also endorsed this and also recommend as an optional for the primary prophylaxis of cryptococcal meningitis. Given the evidence level of C1 based on our study and C4, because there was no study in patients who received ART at that time. Until recently, we have an observational cohort showing that primary prophylaxis in our HIV-infected patient with low CD4 cell count and receive ART, and we follow them for over 6 years, we can show that between those who get primary prophylaxis and those who did not, there was no difference in terms of new occurrence of cryptococcosis and survival. So maybe primary prophylaxis is not really necessary if our patient can get ART, even though they present with low CD4 cell count. So after scaling up of ART around the world, including resource-limited country in poor country, in Africa, in Asia, the incidence of cryptococcal meningitis and other form of cryptococcosis has been much lower compared to the last two decades. However, in the real life, it's not easy to get every HIV patient to receive ART successfully. So before, when we have less cases of cryptococcal meningitis, as a medical teacher, I have to say that my medical student or even my resident of internal medicine never see a case of cryptococcal meningitis at all until they finish their training. So it's not surprised that nowadays many physicians in the primary setting, they're not even aware of cryptococcal meningitis because it's very rare for them. But however, in the real life setting, there are so many patients that still present late, never aware of their HIV infection, or never access to ART. One day they're gonna present to us with cryptococcal meningitis. Even though sometimes they have very typical symptoms and signs, as far as you can just diagnose right away after you tell me three sentences of the history. However, our young doctor, they are not aware of that because they never see it in their medical student studying period. So it may be worth talking about it again today and revisit something that we may have been forgetting. In addition to some patients that present late, never aware of HIV, never get treatment for real because of many reasons, there are still another group of patients who fail to ART. We talk about real life, we not talk about our dream. So in real life, you think about a patient who have to take ART lifelong, every day, every dose. Very easy to get drug resistant and treatment failure. There are so many causes can lead to treatment failure. And once the treatment failure comes, our patient will encounter opportunistic infection. So we still see cryptococcal meningitis, although it's not as often as two decades ago. Cryptococcal meningitis or cryptococcosis in general usually have initial infection with cell-limited pneumonitis in most of the people. But in HIV patients, or especially with low CD4 cell count, per se less than 100 cells per cubic millimeter, the cryptococcus will enter the blood-brain barrier because it has the strong affinity to the central nervous system. So that means over 90% of cryptococcosis in HIV-AIDS patients present with cryptococcal meningitis. Previously, we have a lot of confusing knowledge about cryptococcus neoformans. It had been talking about just different silova, but eventually, until today, we know that they are totally different serotype. So, although there are many species of cryptococcus, only two species, neoformans and gattii, are the species that can affect human and cause the disease in human. And these two species contain of five serotypes that may be interested by many of our mycologists in here. And worldwide, for Cryptococcus neoformans, is a main species to affect HIV-infected patients, whereas gattii is a species mostly infected non-HIV patients. For patients have with cryptococcal meningitis, they usually present with the symptom. The first thing to think about is the alteration of consciousness. It can start with headache or just headache, and sometimes they have confusion, especially for those who have meningoencephalitis as well. And as far as no one detect and diagnose and give good treatment for it, they can progress to be drowsy and comatose level. Some patients may present to us with the sign of increased intracranial pressure, like nausea, vomiting, throwing up all day. Very few of them may have fever, and just 2/3 of them will present to us with stiffness of neck. So that means 1/3 of them, you will never find stiffness of neck when you do physical examination. So you may miss it if you are not aware of it. Some may present with blur vision because we have signal palsy from increased intracranial pressure, and some may have diplopia. When we diagnose in our setting, it's not difficult at all. We can just do lumbar puncture and use the CSF doing in the ink preparation. It's very easy to see, like the picture I show you here. 2 decades ago, every 4th-year medical student, the first year that enter clinical year, they can read cryptococcus from in their ink preparation. But nowadays, even fellow of infectious disease, it's hard for them to tell that this is cryptococcus because the case not as common as before. Or we can diagnose by using cryptococcal antigen and serology. It's the best serology for fungal infection that you can find. So it has high sensitivity and specificity as well. In some cases that you have any reason you cannot do lumbar puncture, you may screen with serum cryptococcal antigen. It may not as sensitive as CSF, but it's very close to CSF, so it's something you can do in case you cannot do lumbar puncture right away. However, in HIV patients, especially when they have very advanced immunodeficiency, they have very little immune response to the yeast in their central nervous system. So when you do lumbar puncture, without sending the cryptococcal antigen testing, you may not find anything abnormal at all in their CSF profile. And this may account for 1/3 of them that may have normal CSF profile. We have a collection of cases of cryptococcal meningitis for over 300 cases. And we try to discriminate the profile between cryptococcal meningitis and tuberculosis meningitis, because both of them, even though cryptococcal meningitis may be more subacute and maybe less to be chronic, and TB may be more chronic, but in some situation, it's very hard to tell by clinical presentation. So the profile I'm listing here may help you a little bit, trying to guide you that this is more likely to be cryptococcal meningitis or TB meningitis. Just one concept. It had much less inflammatory response. So the cell, the protein will be not as high as TB. The glucose may not as low as TB, almost normal. And the India ink is very sensitive. Cryptococcal antigen also very sensitive. So two decades ago, because it's very common, we can train the technician at the rural hospital, 10-bed hospital. We can train them to detect cryptococcal antigen by just a simple latex agglutination test bedside and to diagnose cryptococcal meningitis. Other forms of cryptococcosis may be presented by HIV patients too, although not as common as meningitis. For example, pulmonary cryptococcosis. And quite often too, that some of them present with disseminated cryptococcosis. Again, a decade or 2 decades ago, we trained our medical students. They can detect the skin lesion we call umbilicated papule, or we call papulonecrotic lesion, or some textbook may call it molluscum-like lesion. All this lesion, it will be like skin color or erythematous papule with the central necrosis like umbilicus. And with, when you see this lesion, you can just scrape the lesion, smear on the slide, do the right stain. It's very easy to tell. And for Thailand, we have to tell between three fungus in HIV patient: Cryptococcus, Histoplasma, or Penicillium. So it, when you learn how to discriminate by reading the slide, looking at the morphology and how they replicate, then you can diagnose bedside. Sometimes it's harder that sometimes people not familiar with gram stain, but you may see yeast in the gram stain. So like this case, we get it from a case with osteomyelitis and the pus draining out of the surgical site. And so the people think about bacterial infection first and they do gram stain. And this is a picture we got. And the first one who lead the study told me that there is no organism because they're just looking for bacteria. They're not looking for yeast. Other organ that not as common, maybe eye, liver, peritoneum, kidney, muscle, bone, and adrenal gland, which I have no time to go to detail right now. We'll move to the treatment. We have so limited time, but this is some study, you have to read it. There are many studies trying to looking for antifungal activity for Cryptococcus, but this study demonstrates very well by looking at early fungicidal activity between amphotericin B, amphotericin B plus flucytosine, amphotericin B plus fluconazole, and combined three agents. And we can see that the best EFA you can get is from amphotericin B plus flucytosine. So there is no doubt that it's the best combination, and we know it for almost two decades. But the problem is, in resource-limited setting, flucytosine is not available. That's why we try so hard to come up with another combination of amphotericin B and fluconazole. And there was a study that we did multicenter many sites in Thailand, including in the United States. And we're trying to demonstrate in the clinical phase two study. However, the study showed just a trend of the better survival of fluconazole 800 milligram combined to amphotericin B, and compared to amphotericin B alone, is at a trend toward higher survival. However, since it's almost some hope we could have in the last decade, that's why it's very common in our country and many developing countries that we use amphotericin B plus amphotericin B plus fluconazole, since we do not have flucytosine. In Thailand right now, we have flucytosine, but it's an orphan drug, so it's difficult to get it. Many physicians have very few experience about using it. And we know it's a medicine, it's a drug that discovered before I was born. And it has a lot of toxicity, so it's not easy to use. So let's say if we have limited time, just go to some guideline. It's very easy to do something following guideline. Someone already reviewed the data for us. But trust me, don't believe them all. Listen to someone who are at the front line, who treat the real patient. Okay, I may have some experience to show you, but don't trust me as well. So the guideline I'm going to show you here is a summary from the guideline by CDC and endorsed by Infectious Disease Society of America. And this guideline, only this section of cryptococcosis had been updated 2 years ago, so it's quite updated compared to the IDSA guideline more than 10 years ago. So we all know well that there are three phases of treatment: induction therapy, consolidation therapy, and then maintenance therapy. In induction therapy, the preferred regimen is using liposomal amphotericin B plus full cytosine. And the other preferred regimen is using amphotericin B plus full cytosine. And with the remark that if the cause is an issue, yes, it's always an issue for us. We always have cause issues. So between these two regimen, most of our patients cannot afford liposomal amphotericin B. So however, these two regimen or preferred regimen, both of them we could not afford or we could not get full cytosine. So when we look at alternative regimen in this guideline, there are so many NAMI regimen that offer. One of them at the B1 level is using amphotericin B plus fluconazole based on our study and some other study as well. But you look, they use very high dose of fluconazole, 800 to 1200. I'm telling you, 1200 is not easy at all to use. So most of the case in our country, we use this regimen amphotericin B plus fluconazole 800 milligram. The other alternative regimen you can find here in the guideline, it may be another choice, but when you look in detail, they have quite unacceptable rate of failure and relapse. So you have to go through the detail of each regimen. Consolidation therapy, we still use fluconazole 800 milligram once daily, at least 8 weeks. And maintenance therapy, we use fluconazole for 200 milligram once daily. Don't forget we have to use at least 1 year, even though we can stop when our patient get ART, had successful ART with successful immune restoration. But make sure they get 1 year for at least. Otherwise, you encounter a high rate of relapse of the disease. They also suggest the rule to restart the maintenance therapy again. And the other option to treat the condition we call asymptomatic patient with isolated cryptococcal antigenemia. This is a special population that I cannot go to detail. There are other considerations, but since my time run out already, I'm so sorry. I just want to remind you, don't use corticosteroid. It associated with higher mortality rate. Keep it to use only in high-risk conditions for severe high-risk. Don't use mannitol. Don't use acetazolamide. Other management, if I have one word, since I over the time already, one thing I'm going to tell you, something may be more important to save our patient life, especially in the first 2-3 days, is to control the intracranial pressure. If you don't have antifungal drug in your hand, control the pressure. Your patient, if can go through 3 days, they will not die within 3 days. So you have to do lumbar puncture, release the pressure as much as you can, as often as you need. And sometimes we have a patient who have to do every hour before. So we come up with the procedure we call spinal drainage. If you are interested, you can go to the reference. I put it here. Last thing, to start ART, wait until 5 to 6 weeks, because the study show you very well that if you start ART earlier than 5 weeks, actually, it associates with higher mortality rate. Okay, many reasons behind. One of the reasons, it will come with higher rate of severe IRIS. So for those who not understand about IRIS, I recommend you to go through a lot of detail about IRIS that I put it here in the handout. You can look, but I don't have time to show you. Okay, so let's use this one as a summarize for my talk that for the success to management of patient with cryptococcal meningitis in HIV and AIDS patient, early diagnosis, especially when the patient have the symptom and sign that not typical, use appropriate antifungal therapy, control the pressure, start ART with the right regimen at the right time, and always anticipate for iris, then you get success for the taking care of patients with cryptococcal meningitis. Thank you.